Good morning, Newport Mesa Church. I'm used to welcome you into the congregation, into our worship auditorium, but today you are welcoming us into your home, and so I want to say thank you. I also want to just say what's up to anyone who is tuning in who isn't really a part of our church. We want to say welcome, and our hope is that you would be encouraged today, that you would find something in the service, Lord, that someone sang about, someone talked about, that would encourage you, that would just encourage your soul, your spirit, and our deepest desire is that you would know Christ. And so that's really our hope. There's a lot of things that are changing right now. A lot of things in our society are changing for a season, but there is one thing that hasn't changed for us, and I can speak for our church, and that is that our desire is still to grow in our relationship with Christ. And I'll tell you, a couple people that have been so helpful in this journey have been Pastor Pete, the worship team, the communications team. So please, please, please send them a message encouraging them. They have just done a phenomenal job. The last couple weeks, we've been doing this series called Crucible. And next week is actually our last week. And it's going to be a dynamic message. You definitely want to tune in. But the idea of the series is defining moments. And we've all had a defining moment that has shaped us. And sometimes it's shaped us for good, and sometimes it's shaped us for bad. But defining moments shape us. In fact, the definition of a crucible is a stressful event or season. And then the next definition is a container where metals are refined. And I believe that a crucible moment, first definition, God can use like the second definition, that he's refining our character. He's shaping us into who he's called us to be and who he's called us to do. I believe that God wants to redefine our crucible moments. And so my prayer for you is that whatever crucible moment that you're facing is, that you would allow God to redefine it. I know that all of us are facing the coronavirus. That's just in our faces. But I also know that there are other issues in society, that God is calling Christians to rise up and stand in opposition against, stand for God on behalf of. And David is a great example of someone who does that. And God uses Goliath and the Philistines to prop up David and to establish really his leadership in the nation. So I want you to go ahead and turn with me in your Bibles to 1 Samuel chapter 17. And when you're turning there, I want to actually just give you the reasons to watch church online. As you're turning to 1 Samuel chapter 17, we're going to throw this up on the screen. Four reasons to watch church online. Are you ready? This is something new for all of us, right? We're all experiencing this for the first time. Number one, no parking. Come on, that's good right there. You didn't have to mess with parking this morning. Southern California is terrible. Or you can't find the parking. It's just bad. Our place is pretty good, but a lot of people struggle with parking. Number two, refill your coffee anytime. I mean, people aren't going to notice if you get up right now and make yourself a whole nother cup. So, like, stay caffeinated. I'm just encouraging you. Number three, relax in your pajamas. That is what I'm talking about. We are well, I'm not relaxing, but you're relaxing in your pajamas. That's good stuff. And then finally, number four, I think this is going to be good for you. If I get a little too passionate, a little too into it, you can mute your pastor. How many of you know what a remote control is? Just go ahead and try it out right now. You can turn it down. No sound guy is going to get any complaints today, because you're just going to have to talk to the person with the remote, because it's in your hands at this moment. So again, reasons to watch online. Just to bring some laughter to the table. Here we go, 1 Samuel 17, 55 through 58. That's what we're going to be reading. But before we get there, I want to just think about some of the different issues that I believe God is calling the church specifically to stand up in opposition for. I just believe that God has called us to stand for freedom. I believe God has called us to stand for people's ability to make decisions for themselves. I believe that it's important that people have the freedom that God has called them to experience. I believe God has called us to stand up for life. He's called us to stand up for those who are hurting. He's called us to stand up for people who are lonely and full of anxious thoughts. Even in this moment with the coronavirus, there are people maybe in your neighborhood that are struggling, and God has called us to stand up for them. And God has called us to stand up for some things that some of us as adults have kind of gotten away from. But the reality is this coronavirus, I believe, has allowed us to feel something that we haven't felt for a long time. All of a sudden, we're not in control. All of a sudden, we are. It feels like we're being oppressed and we're being forced to do things in a certain way. And I totally understand. This is all a part of the process of flattening the curve, and we want to do our part to protect the most vulnerable and those with compromised immune systems. But still, it has that sense. And there is an issue that is a big deal in our teenage world that I actually want to, especially because our teens are with us today, even some of our elementary kids and our junior high kids, and it's the topic of bullying. We're talking about crucible moments, and one of the kinds of crucible moments that some people face is, what do you do when you are bullied? Did you know that 30% of kids worldwide are bullied every year? That's one out of every three kids. And bullying is actually the number one act of violence against young people in America today. It's kind of shocking to realize that, but my thought process is simply this. Sometimes a crucible moment for someone else can be a defining moment in our lives if we're willing to stand up for them. I want you to check this video out.
Scrawny, chubby, short,
queer.
Getting caught up in bullying, it's so easy because you're just glad that you're not being bullied.
It's been hard for me to stand up for other people because I feel like I'm already a target.
It's just easier to do nothing.
Stop.
Fine.
Dude, ow.
Fine.
Stop.
Fine.
Ow. Stop.
Do you have any friends?
Yes, I heard you.
What are you even doing here? It's almost too easy.
Ow. Stop.
Come on.
I get it.
Maybe
I
you
get
are
it.
A little bit more.
Ooh. You think you're special? One Whopper Junior meal.
I just opened it up and it's all smashed.
Did you order bullied or unbullied?
Bullied or unbullied?
Yeah.
Do you have a manager that I can speak to? Because that doesn't even make any sense.
Hi,
your manager.
Hi, how's it going?
I was given this.
Did you bully this burger?
Well, yeah. This is a defenseless Whopper Jr. It can't defend itself.
You don't mean anything by it.
It's just for
it's
laughs.
Just for laughs.
Just give me my burger, man.
What the is going on here? What? Are you, is there something wrong with you?
Because that's clearly what happened.
Can't be serious.
Had you seen me bullying this burger, would you have stood up and said something?
Yeah.
It's good to know.
Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm okay.
Yeah? What's your name?
Reese.
Hi, Reese.
We're just having fun.
You having fun? He's not having fun. So therefore, I think you guys should just leave him alone.
Later. This feels better to me.
Have you ever been, like, messed with before?
Oh, my God. Like, the ideal world is where if somebody else sees, like, something weird happening, that they'll come over and be like, hey, this is not okay.
Yeah.
To feel defenseless, that's the one of the worst things in the world.
Chelsea came and she would just tell them that it's not okay.
Because it isn't.
Something I'll never forget is my friend standing up for me.
I've been that kid, so if I see it, I'm gonna do something about it. And I hope there's more people out there like that.
Wow. What would you do if you came to a McDonald's or a Burger King or some fast food restaurant and you witnessed what we just saw? What would you do? It was kind of a social experiment that this particular restaurant did, just to see how people would respond. And unfortunately, not everyone responded the same way. It's always interesting to me what we do in response to seeing other people get hurt, get bullied, get oppressed. And friends, my thought is simply this, that in moments where we see oppression happening, David saw it in his fellow Israelites. But I believe we're also seeing it with this coronavirus. There are going to be people who are impacted by it. There are going to be people who get the virus, who are struggling. They don't have food. And this is going to be a moment where we can stand up and do something about it. I believe this is what will happen when we do that. We'll stand out. In fact, the question that I have for us today is just simply this. What do we want to be remembered for? What do we want to be remembered by? I know that it's hard to think, like, what's going to happen after all of this? But the truth is, this too shall pass. The coronavirus will pass. Your bowling season will pass. Your crucible moment will pass. And what do we want to say about our lives, about how we acted in this moment in response? What do we want to be remembered for? It's with that thought that I head to 1 Samuel 17, verses 55 through 58. I'm just going to read it for us today. As soon as Saul saw David go out against the Philistine, he said to Abner, the commander of the army, "Abner, whose son is this youth?" And Abner said, "As your soul lives, O king, I don't know." And the king said, "Inquire whose son the boy is." And as soon as David returned from the striking down of the Philistine, Abner took him and brought him before Saul with the head of the Philistine in his hand. And Saul said to him, "Whose son are you, young man?" And David answered, I am the son of your servant, Jesse, the Bethlehemite." Here we are at the end of the story, really. All is said and done. David steps up to the line. He actually runs to the line. And he defeats Goliath. God helps him. He uses David to bring reprieve to the Israelites who are being bullied. They're being bullied by this guy. They're oppressed. They're under his, you know, his taunts and his accusations, and David defeats Goliath with God's help. And he stands up for God's cause, which is freedom. God has many causes, but freedom is this underlying theme you see throughout all of Scripture, that God desires people to be free to worship him. And David stands up for God's cause, and because he stands up for God's cause, he stands out. David stands out to the people around him. He stands out to his king. He stands out to Abner. And he certainly stands out to all of the Israelites. In fact, God uses this crucible moment to help David stand out. And David becomes a mighty military leader. In fact, that's the reason why they want to know where David is from. They want to know, who do we need to talk to enlist this young man into our army? I want to ask this question. Are we standing up for God's causes? What would happen if we stood up for God in this moment as our nation is facing this crisis? What if we called people to prayer? What if we brought food to our neighbors? What if we showed kindness even when they don't deserve it? What if we ran to the battle line? What would we be remembered for? Friends, I have felt God impress this on my heart since the moment I started to really pray about this, that God is going to use this moment to position the church to reach more hurting people. I believe that in a place like Orange County, and maybe it's very similar to wherever you are tuning into, people almost feel invincible, like they can't be touched. And yet, there is this sense of vulnerability that is being fleshed out, that if we would speak to that vulnerability and offer God and the desire that God has to be a strong tower for those who are hurting, I just believe that people would come to Christ, and people would notice that there would be something significant that happens. See, David stands up for God's cause, and he stands out to the people around him, and he uses this moment in the life of Israel and the life of David as almost a platform to propel his leadership. And what would it look like for us to stand up for God's causes? Friends, I believe that we would also stand out. We talked a little bit about bullying earlier, and one of the inspiring stories that I've heard from our own congregation in the last couple years is the story of Rebecca Robeck. She started an organization called Let's Be Kind, and I wanted her to tell you a little bit more about the journey that she and her family has taken with Let's Be Kind.
I'm Rebecca Robeck. I'm a sophomore at Costa Mesa High School, and I'm the founder of Let's Be Kind Day. So Let's Be Kind Day is where we literally just spread kindness to our campus. We're going to have over 14 schools doing this, so we have these t-shirts in different colors. We like to make it different each year. We go up on the intercom and we explain what Let's Be Kind Day is. It's a day where we spread kindness to everybody, where we want to unify the school, and we're just going to be passing out these t-shirts, so make sure you come get your free t-shirt. So that's really what Let's Be Kind Day is, in the sense of like the actual day. It was just a different culture coming back here. It was kind of hard for me to like get used to it, because people weren't using kindness in their everyday lives. Like, people would tell me, like, your hair looks weird. And they would step on my shoes and they would make fun of the way I speak Spanish, because I'm not a native Spanish speaker, but I learned Spanish living in El Salvador. I actually would go home and like tell my mom about it, and finally she had enough of it, and she was like, so what are you going to do about it? And I was like, oh, what am I going to do about it? And so we came up with the idea of just getting these Costco pizzas and having these little papers on it that said, let's be kind to one another. We went in one day just passing out pizza, and I feel like that day it was more so about the pizza, because like, it's free pizza, like you're not gonna really notice what it says. But the people that helped me pass out the pizza, we really made it the idea of kindness shown through the act of giving the pizza out. And so it went from that to me wanting to do more. So my mom was like, okay, like, I'll make a logo and we'll see what we can do with it. And we put it on t-shirts, and I was like, let's pass this out to every student on the middle school side of the campus. And so that's what we did. So the first year we didn't really have any obstacles, because we didn't really like talk to the school about it. We were just like, we're here, we're gonna do it. At the beginning, the principal was like, what's this? Like, and so it took a while to like get the idea into the school. But then as we moved forward into the high school, that was where everything was like, oh my goodness, like, this is gonna be harder than we thought it was gonna be. Majority of high schools that just don't like the idea of Let's Be Kind, it's not something that's usual for them or regular. And so just some pushback from schools, that's what we've gotten. For me personally, my mom has been with me this whole entire time. And I know that even if like I didn't have my mom with me, I know that God is always on my side and always walking me through these situations. But there was definitely a time where me and my mom both felt like we're the only ones that really care about Let's Be Kind. We're the only ones that are trying to get this onto our campus. My mom, she does not cry. She is not a crier. But this one time, she just started bawling because she was like, I do not know what to do. I feel so defeated. I feel like this isn't going to happen. Like, I don't understand why this is so hard. I feel like God should be making it doors wide open. And so my family at the time, we were reading the Bible. Nobody thought that David was going to be Goliath. But because of the strength that God gave him, because of this small little stone, he threw it and he knocked down Goliath, all with the power of God. That just like shows how much you can count on God, even through hard things that people may not think that it's going to happen. You may not even think it's going to happen, but through God's love and God's power, like, those things will become a reality. So the main one is that we just want to see the culture change completely. And I know that sounds like crazy, because like, it's a culture, it's just how things are. What I mean by changing the culture is that kids will start using kindness in their everyday lives. It'll be the cool thing to be kind. And so that's like the main goal right now. The main overall goal for like Let's Be Kind is to really have it on every school campus like in the world, and be able to share kindness throughout all the schools. We actually have a website where you can if you want to start a Let's Be Kind on your own campus, you can go to our website, letsbekind.org, and you can email us. You can, there's like a little thing that like you can give your information and say, I want to start this on my campus, and we'll give you all the resources to do that. We'll talk with you. We'll like give you a plan. We'll help you figure everything out. If you want to do it, just do it. Reach out to us and we'll help you out. The t-shirts are a big part of it. And we know that the day is specifically for kids, but usually those kids like bring t-shirts like home to their parents. But if you don't have one, on our website again, you can get a t-shirt. But just wearing the t-shirt, it really like kind of sparks an idea in people's mind, like, hey, that person is wearing like Let's Be Kind. It just kind of reminds them like, hey, maybe I should be nice to that grocery store person, or like just be kind to like people in general and like people around you in your everyday life. And it really isn't that hard to be kind to people. And so I just think being more mindful of like how you're treating people and what you're saying.
Thank you so much, yeah. Rebecca, just for sharing with us today. And we're excited to hear the story from you about Let's Be Kind and what God is doing and how you took advantage of that moment in your life where you felt God moving you on to act and to do something. And so we just want to say thank you so much for joining us today.
I am so grateful for the next generation coming up. I mean, there's no hesitation. I'm just excited. Rebecca, we're so proud of you. We believe in you. We know that God is with you. He's walking with you. Even the fact that God put the story of David and Goliath in your heart just shows me that the Spirit of God is just speaking to you in powerful ways. We're excited. We're just excited for what God is going to do. And Rebecca, when you stand up for God's causes, you get noticed, and you have been noticed. In fact, there have been different agencies and schools and even causes and organizations that have brought you in to speak because they want to know, why are you doing this? What started this in your life? And that same question that I asked earlier, I want to ask one more time. What are we doing in this crucible moment? Are we showing kindness? Are we going above and beyond? Are we using this opportunity where people are being hurt by this virus, by even just the circumstances of the virus? They're isolated, they're lonely. Are we calling people? Are we texting people? Are we doing what we can so that people know that they're not alone? Did we reach out to our neighbors, the vulnerable in our own lives? Have we reached out with the love of God and specifically with the message of Jesus Christ, that the peace that he can offer will literally guard their minds and their hearts? I'm so grateful that we serve a God that desires for us to stand up for his causes so that we can stand out, not in a way that brings attention to ourselves, but in a way that brings attention to him and honestly brings relief to people who are hurting. I heard a story this week as people are just doing what they can to stand up for what's right, of people not out of obligation, but because of a genuine desire in their own heart, are standing up and doing things that they normally wouldn't do. I heard of a story of some retired engineers who got on Facebook and started this project called the Open Source Ventilator Project because of the potential risk and threat of running out of ventilators as one of the consequences of COVID-19. And because of their open source sharing, they've actually created a prototype for building ventilators for people if they get into the position that they can make from just things laying around in their own house. I mean, what a cool way to stand up for something that you believe in because it's something that's in your heart. And when we stand up for the right things, people notice. That is the kind of story that I want to push online. That's the kind of story that I want to repeat because all of us have gifts that we can use to stand up. But in the midst of doing the right thing, we live in a very unique age. There's social media and there's different kinds of motivations. And so I just want to offer three cautions to us as we respond to the coronavirus, as we do the ministry that Rebecca is doing, Let's Be Kind, and all of the different kinds of ministries that we do. I could mention all sorts of ministries of Christians stepping up and using what God has given to them to stand up for God's causes and to help hurting people. I just want to give three cautions from our talk today, just to make sure we're doing it in the right way. Number one, we need to check our motives. We need to check our motives. We don't stand up for something so that we can stand out only. We stand up for things because it's the right thing to do. And so I want to give you an easy way to understand, maybe as you're thinking, man, do I post this? Do I use social media to stand up for something? Three questions that you can use just this week as you're thinking about things to repost or questions to post or posts to post, whatever. Number one, is the need real? Is the need real? Number two, is my desire to help real? Again, we're checking our motivations, and if our motivation is wrong, it still may help people, but it may not be the best time to do it. We want to do it with good motivation. Is my desire to help real? And number three, can the technology help in a real way? We're dealing with social media. We're talking about things that are impacting us, and we want to do the right thing and stand up in the right way, but we also want to do it with the right heart. So check our motives. Now, here's the deal with checking our motives. If we wait till our motivation is perfect, we're never going to do anything. So at some point, click the button, share the message. You know, I mean, it's just like we're weighing that tension, but I just want to encourage you, do it with the right motives. That's the first caution. The second caution is simply this: don't manipulate. The reward for what we're trying to do in response to this crucible moment, to start this ministry, to serve on this dream team, to post this message, or to whatever, do whatever to help the kid that's getting bullied, is to not do it for the wrong reasons, but to do it because it's the right thing to do to help that person. I heard a famous pastor once say this: if we reach the people no one wants, God will give us the people that everyone wants. And man, I just was so excited when I heard that until I really started to think about it, and I thought, well, what am I doing this for anyways? Am I doing this so that I can get the people that no one wants? And I thought, or that everyone wants? And I just thought, no, that's not what God calls us to. God calls us to reach people who are hurting, regardless of whether they're popular or not popular. He's called us to stand up for his causes because the people that are being impacted are people. They're God's sons and they're God's daughters. And so we reach people, whoever, because it's the right thing. And helping people is the right thing. And we don't want to manipulate our own hearts or other people's hearts because we're trying to get to an outcome. We're going to do things because they're just right. And sometimes I'm bummed because it feels like people don't appreciate when you've stuck your neck out on the line for them. In fact, in ministry, this can happen a lot. I'm sure this has happened to you in your jobs. This has probably happened to you as you've gotten involved in churches. You're maybe one of your neighbors. Maybe you brought food this week to someone who couldn't go out, and they just seem really ungrateful. I don't know. I was talking to one of the people who kind of mentors me. He provides counsel in my life. I'd call him a mentor, and I was just explaining just that tension, you know, like how do you overcome that? Like, you want people to respond positively, especially when you're pouring out your heart and you're trying to do the right thing. People can be really mean and nasty in response. And he said this. It was just a real a clear encouragement to me. He said, Jordan, you don't do things for people to respond in a certain way. You do things because you are human and they are human, and you did your best to do the right thing to help another human. And I can't think of a better encouragement in the middle of this coronavirus. You may be doing things that nobody even notices or sees, but that doesn't matter. We aren't doing anything to be seen. We don't stand up for God's causes to be seen. It's just one of the things that happens. It doesn't motivate us, and it's not the reason we trick ourselves into doing it. That's not how we do it. And then the third caution is simply this. And this is a good caution, but it can also be kind of a warning. It can be a reward or a warning. God notices. God is watching. He is seeing everything. And someday, I've seen this post just in the last week in our own prayer page. You know, someday we are going to stand before God, and we are going to answer him for everything that we've done, everything that we've said, in the crucible moments, how we responded, and how we didn't respond. We're going to answer for how we interact with people when they've stuck their neck out on the line for us and when we've stuck our neck out on the line for them. And God is going to notice everything. He sees everything. And thank God, he will see the moments that you have given, that you have served, that you have tried to start something, a movement. Rebecca, God sees the blood, sweat, and the tears that you have poured into this thing, and he sees what your family has sacrificed, and God notices, he sees. And I just want to remind us that even if nobody else notices, even if nobody else pays attention, God pays attention. He's watching. And when we check in on our neighbors, God's watching. When we're serving on a church dream team, God is watching. When we're living a generous life with those around us and nobody knows what we're giving to or who we're giving to or what we're giving to the church, nobody knows except for God. God notices. And friend, I want to encourage you this week. If nobody notices, my promise to you is that God will notice. But here's the cool thing. Here's the cool thing. Every once in a while, God lets us see the results or some of the cool things that have happened because of our efforts. I wanted to share a letter that I got. It wasn't about me, but a letter that kind of shows you what I mean by that. By this. It starts out by saying this: Hi all, it's been so long since I talked to all of you. I feel so blessed to be able to see you through Facebook. Your family made such a huge impact on my life because if that I wanted to share a special moment I was able to have with my son yesterday. Eric and I, that's her husband, took the kids to the park. Washington was finally having a good day. And while there, my daughter Lily was asking me why I named her Lily. When I told her it was after a really old movie that I loved, we looked the movie up and both laughed about it. It's a ridiculous movie that I still love. My son overheard and asked the same question. Why did we name him James? That's when the lump in my throat grew and I got teary-eyed. My husband told him, this is a story only your mother can tell. That is when I had the great pleasure of talking about your dad. How going to church was just a thing we were supposed to do. Until I met Pastor Jim. He made me crave Jesus. I told him all the stories I could remember about him and your family. Now, before I tell you the best part, my son has always struggled with confidence and his abilities. He has a strong personality, but struggles in school, and with that, it has caused a lot of doubt. So when talking to him about what he wants to be when he grows up, he never knows. He says that he isn't good at anything. Breaks the heart of a mama. Of course, we boost him in every way we can. Yesterday evening, after saying our bedtime prayers together, James said, you know what, Mom? I want to be a Pastor Jim, too. I want to change someone's life like he did yours. And if I'm named after him, maybe that means I could do it, too. It was a euphoric moment. Thank you so much for sharing him and yourselves with all of us for so many years. I just wanted to share that even in heaven, he is still changing lives. Love you all. You know, the interesting thing about that story is my dad passed away before he could ever hear it. Before he would ever know the impact on this woman's life on an individual basis and the extension of that influence on her son and how there's a young man who's growing up with a name named after someone that he's never met, but he has been hugely impacted by. Friends, when we stand up for God, when we stand up for people, when we stand up for the things that God stands up for, we stand out to the world. And we don't always stand out for the reasons that they love, and sometimes they don't like the fact that we stand out, but we stand out. And when you stand up for the things that God is calling you to stand up for, people are going to notice. And all of this craziness with the coronavirus has really made me even more aware that our time on this earth, none of us know how much we'll have. We are far more vulnerable than any of us realize. And I want to just speak from my heart for a second. If you don't get anything from this message, get this. Your life means something because God has called you to stand up for what he has called you to stand up for. The causes, the values, the truth, God wants you to stand up. And there will be people whose lives are impacted. There will be people who notice the way that you live your life during this moment, during this crucible moment, facing the coronavirus. They'll see you respond in faith, not fear. They will see you respond with courage, not cowardice. They will feel your prayers, not your panic. They will see you helping people focus on Scripture. I want you to understand your actions matter in this moment more than anything else. They matter more than the financial situation. They matter more than the physical situation, even the healthcare situation. I believe as the church rises up to pray and to embody the heart of God facing this thing, our church and our church all over the country and world can be positioned to receive, I believe, the millions and millions of people that are going to say, wow, I didn't think the church was relevant until they stood up in a moment and I saw what they did and I took a great notice. They were not afraid and I was terrified and I want to be like that. Friends, I just believe that there's going to be a whole generation that needs to see us stand up for the things that God has called us to stand up for. and I believe that we're going to stand out. In fact, it made me think of a passage in Daniel, and it's in chapter 12. It's actually a reference to the end times. It says this: "At that time shall arise Michael, the great prince who has charge over your people, and there shall be a time of trouble such as never been since there was a nation till that time. But at that time your people shall be delivered, everyone whose name shall be found written in the book, and many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the sky above. And those who turn many to righteousness shall, like the stars, be forever and ever." And friends, I want to close just with a simple idea for you to think about this week. I have one of these big mag lights, and these mag lights can operate as more than just a light, right? They're literally like a weapon. But, you know, this thing is like just heavy and it's big and I love it. And what I love about a mag light is when the lights go out and I have this with me and I turn it on and everything goes dark, I can see where I'm going because of the brightness of the light. And what happens in crucible moments is everything goes dark. That's how it's felt like these last couple weeks. But what can happen as we allow the Spirit to lead us, as we run to the battle line, as we stand up for what God wants us to stand for, we begin to shine with the light of Jesus through our life. And people who are searching right now, they're searching. They're trying to figure out where they are. They're looking for the person with the light. And friends, I want to encourage you to be the light, to let the light of Christ shine in you so that you can be exactly what Daniel is talking about, like a star in the heavens of the night sky, so that people can see where they're going. I want to pray for you. If you've never given your life to Christ, I want to just say a quick prayer right now, because you cannot shine unless you have the light of Jesus shining in you. God wants to literally illuminate your life so that others can see, and he wants to lead you and guide you, but you have to be willing to follow him because he's the greatest light that we have. Would you bow your heads with me right now, right where you are, right in your living room? If that's you, Father, just repeat this after me. Father, I give you my life. I need the light of Christ shining in me so that I will know where to shine, how to shine with the right motives, to shine to help people so that I can stand out, not for myself, but for you. But for you. I give you my life, God. Jesus, I trust you with my life. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. We're going to go ahead and close our service, and there's going to be some ways for you to worship, but I encourage you to not click mute yet. Let's worship with one more song, and then we're going to post some questions at the end of our time together so that you can facilitate some application, some discussion, some conversation with your family today and apply God's word to your life. God bless.
Hey, this is Pete from Newport Mesa Church. We want to thank you for joining us today. Here at Newport Mesa Church, we're all about changed lives. If this message encouraged you, we'd love to hear about your story. So connect with us on our webpage or email us at info@newportmesa.org. If you'd like to support the ministry here, you can give through our website or our mobile app. Thanks again for tuning in, and we hope to see you next week.